हेलो, अस्सलाम वालेकुम एवरीवन। माय नेम इज़ डॉक्टर फारूक जावेद एंड टुडे वी विल स्टडी अबाउट इंट्राक्रैनियल प्रेशर। सो इन द स्टार्ट वी विल डिस्कस अबाउट द नॉर्मल रेंजेस ऑफ इंट्राक्रैनियल प्रेशर एंड डिफरेंट कंपोनेंट्स ऑफ इंट्राक्रैनियल प्रेशर। देन वी विल गो फॉर द रेज ICP, इट्स डेफिनेशन, पैथोलॉजी, क्लिनिकल फीचर्स एंड इट्स कॉन्सिक्वेंसेज। एंड देन वी विल स्टडी अबाउट द मेथड्स टू मेजर इंट्राक्रैनियल प्रेशर एंड द मैनेजमेंट ऑफ रेज इंट्राक्रैनियल प्रेशर। So first of all, what is the normal value of intracranial pressure? It is difficult to establish a universal normal value for ICP because there are variations in age, body posture and clinical condition of the patients. But we go for our range, that is from 5 to 15 millimeter of mercury for the normal intracranial pressure, and the upper limit is 15 millimeter of mercury. Intracranial volume is measured by the three components: brain, blood and CSF, and the total intracranial volume is 1700 ml. Blood and CSF contributes 10% of each, and the major component is brain that contributes 80% of the volume of intracranial cavity, that is 1400 ml. It's important to know about the cerebral perfusion pressure because this pressure is to be maintained for the normal function of the brain. So how do we calculate cerebral perfusion pressure? It's equal to mean arterial pressure minus intracranial pressure. And the normal range is 70 to 100 millimeter of mercury for cerebral perfusion pressure. And then how do we calculate the mean? Mean is to be calculated as 1/3 of systolic plus 2/3 of diastolic blood pressure. And how do we calculate ICP? We will study in the next slides, in the coming slides. Then it's important to know about the cerebral blood flow. Flow is equal to pressure divided by resistance. And we calculate the cerebral blood flow as cerebral perfusion pressure divided by cerebral vascular resistance. There are different methods to measure the cerebral blood flow, and generally it can be measured through the Doppler ultrasound, transcranial Doppler ultrasound. So as you all know, we already studied about the Monroe-Kelly doctrine in the previous presentation. So skull is a closed hard cavity that constitutes three components: brain tissue, CSF and blood. And a fourth component has to be adjusted by the shift of any of these components out of the cavity. Here we can see in the upper bar, you can see there are the normal components of the intracranial cavity: brain, blood and CSF. If a mass or the fourth component comes, the CSF shifts first of these, and then in the next blood will go out, and in the last there will be cerebral herniation. So what are different compensatory mechanisms? Immediately there will be decrease in the CSF volume, and then next will be the blood volume, and in the last or delayed there will be extracellular fluid that will be decreased, and then there will be irreversible changes that can be cerebral herniation. So these are the compensatory mechanism to control the intracranial masses. So what if the compensatory mechanisms fail? There will be pathological changes that can cause brain edema, brain herniation and ischemia, especially if the cerebral perfusion pressure is lowered to the 30 to 40 millimeter of mercury. This is important that we act before these ranges and before these pathological changes. So this is a slide where you can see intracranial pressure versus intracranial volume. Intracranial volume can be increased, but the intracranial pressure is still maintained initially. But once the compliance is decreased, there will be sudden shift in the intracranial pressure, and there will be increased risk of cerebral ischemia and herniation, and in the last there will be complete collapse of cerebral microvasculature, and there it will cause brain death. So what is RAISE ICP? RAISE ICP is intracranial pressure of more than 20 millimeter of mercury. what are the different pathologies that can cause intracranial pressure? These can be divided into two: increased volume of intracranial constituent, the normal constituents of the intracranial cavity like brain, CSF or blood. And the second etiology can be a space occupying lesion, and these lesion can be localized mass lesions, disturbance of CSF circulation, obstruction to major venous sinuses, diffuse brain edema or swelling, or idiopathic can. So what are different localized mass lesions? These can be traumatic hematomas, neoplasias, abscess or focal edema secondary to trauma, infarction or tumor. And then there can be disturbance of CSF circulation like obstructed hydrocephalus or communicated hydrocephalus. Then there can be obstruction to major venous sinuses, depressed fracture overlying major venous sinuses causing the rupture of the venous sinuses or blockage of the venous sinuses. And then there can be cerebral venous thrombosis. Then there can be diffuse brain edema or swelling like encephalitis, meningitis, diffuse head injuries, subarachnoid hemorrhages and so on. So these can also cause the raised intracranial pressure. Then there can be idiopathic causes like benign intracranial hypertension. So here are the different examples. Here you can see different types of pathologies that can cause intracranial pressure, especially the traumatic causes like epidural hematoma, subdural hematoma, subarachnoid hemorrhages, depressed fractures, cerebral contusions. Then there can be intracranial hematomas. Then there can be intracranial lesions like abscess or brain tumors. And then there can be the hydrocephalus. So these are different pathologies that can raise intracranial pressure. So what can be the clinical findings? There is no consistent relationship between the severity of symptoms and the degree of hypertension. And by hypertension, I mean intracranial hypertension. So the most common symptom is headache. So headache is caused by the traction on the vessel or the compression on the dura. And the features of headache can be, it can be a throbbing or bursting headache. And it will be worse in the morning. And it can be exacerbated by any factors that further increase intracranial pressure like coughing, sneezing, or any other Valsalva manoeuvres. And it can be relieved by vomiting and analgesia. Then there can be associated symptoms like vomiting, disorientation, lethargy, visual disturbances. And then there can be different signs like hypertension, bradycardia, depressed global consciousness, papilloedema, cranial nerve palsies, especially the sixth nerve palsy, spontaneous periorbital bruising, projectile vomiting. So here you can see the early and the late signs. Headache can be early and the late as well. Similarly, loss of consciousness can be there early and the late. But in the late, there will be difficult to arouse, decreasing GCS, papilloedema can be there, especially in the cases of delayed features. Then there can be different posturing that can show the motor disturbance, and the memory loss can be in the earlier signs of the intracranial raised intracranial pressure, and the questioning triad will be observed late. But few of the components of the questioning triad can be seen early as well. So decrease in motor response can be shown in two forms, decorticate and decerebrate. Decorticate is interruption of the voluntary motor cortex, and the posture can be the flexion of the arms and then the extension of the knees and plantar flexion. And the decerebrate, it is caused by disruption of motor fibers in the midbrain and brainstem, and the posture can be extended arms, then the flex hands, and extension of the knees and plantar flexion. So these two postures can show the decrease in motor response. Then the Cushing triad. Cushing triad is increased blood pressure, decreased heart rate, and decreased respiratory rate or altered respiratory rate. So increased blood pressure, that is hypertension, decreased heart rate, that is bradycardia, and respiratory irregularities. These are the three components of the Cushing triad. So we have to differentiate the Cushing triad from the shock. So in Cushing triad, we know that there will be increased blood pressure, decreased pulse, and decreased respiration. But in shock, the blood pressure will be decreased, pulse will be increased, and respiration will also be increased. So this is the difference between the Cushing triad and shock. So what can be the consequences of raised ICP? The worst consequences can be the hypoxic ischemic brain injury and mechanical compression and herniation of brain. Both of these can be lethal. So what are different types of brain herniation? Brain herniation are generally divided into four forms, but can be extended to the six forms. So generally, as you can see, the number one, it is the subfalcine herniation, or also called the cingulate gyrus herniation. Second one is the sphenoidal herniation. Then number three is the uncal herniation through the tentorium. And then there can be the tonsillar herniation through foramen magnum. Then additional can be the two herniation. Number five, that can be the upward herniation if there is a large posterior fossa or infratentorial mask with a decrease with sudden release of the CSF. Then there can be the number six. It can be a transcalvary herniation through the skull fractures. So these are the different types of brain herniation. So the midline shift. Midline is marked as a line drawn from the crista galli from the frontal bone to the internal occipital protuberance in the occipital bone. So this a line can be drawn, and this is the midline. And if there is shift of the fox or the brain cerebral hemisphere from this midline, we call it the midline shift. There can be different ranges. It can be calculated in the millimeter if more than 5 mm of midline shift is significant midline shift. Then the indication of intracranial monitoring, intracranial pressure monitoring. The main indications can be low GCS, that is below 8, different posturing like the decorticate and decerebrate postures, bilateral or unilateral pupil dilatation. CT scan result that can show edema and or the midline shift, physical assessment or neurological assessment findings which indicate a need for monitoring. So these can be the common indication of intracranial monitoring. Then how to measure the intracranial pressure? There are different methods, non-invasive and invasive methods. Non-invasives can be tissue resonance analysis, TRA, oculosonography, transcranial Doppler ultrasound, intraocular pressure, and tympanic membrane displacement. And then invasive can be subdural, subarachnoid, intraparenchymal, intraventricular, and lumbar puncture. So non-invasive tissue resonance analysis, it is an ultrasound based method, and it can help us to monitor the intracranial pressure non-invasively. Then there can be associated oculosonography ultrasound that can measure the optic nerve sheath diameter. Then the transcranial ultrasound that can measure the velocity of blood flow in the proximal cerebral circulation. Then we can also measure intraocular pressure. That can be a non-invasive method to measure intracranial pressure. It can be done through the ultrasonic handheld optic tonometer. And then we can also examine the tympanic membrane for its displacement, or through the impedance audiometer. So the invasive one. Here you can see we can place a bolt or the probe at the epidural space, subdural space, subarachnoid space, intraparenchymal or intraventricular, or even the lumbar puncture can be done to measure invasive intracranial pressure monitoring. So how do we pass a probe in the intracranial cavity? We make a burr hole after incising the scalp, and then we place our probes. So here you can see, once we place our probe inside the cranial cavity, we attach it with the monitor and we calculate the intracranial pressure. The probe can be, as already discussed, probe can be placed extradurally, subdurally, or subarachnoidally, intraparenchymal or intraventricular, but the most common method which is used for intracranial pressure monitoring is the placement of the probe inside the ventricles. So this is the easiest method. Then we have to also monitor the waveforms that can be observed in the intracranial pressure waves. The flow of three upstrokes in one wave can be seen, and the P1, P2 and P3 are the normal waves. P1 is the percussion wave that represents the arterial pulsation, P2 is the tidal wave that represents the intracranial compliance, and P3 is dicrotic wave that represents the venous pulsation. So these are the normal waveforms of the intracranial pressure monitoring. In normal intracranial pulmonation, P1 should be the highest upstroke, P2 in between, and P3 should show the lowest upstroke. On eyeballing the monitor, if P2 is higher than P1, it indicates the intracranial hypertension. So the simply, if you see of the a waveform and P2 is higher than the higher, if the P2 is higher than the P1, it simply shows the intracranial hypertension or raised ICP. So now, how do we manage the raised ICP? There are two types of methods: general management and specific management. Then the general management can be done through the resuscitation, positioning or posturing of the patient with the head elevation, IV fluids like we can add the mannitol to it, or the hypertonic saline can be added to decrease the intracranial pressure. Then we can also go to treat the cause, and then hyperventilation can be one method to decrease the intracranial pressure. Sedation to reduce metabolic demand and metabolic activities, and then blood pressure control to maintain cerebral perfusion pressure above 60 millimeter of mercury. Then the definite management, it is best to treat the cause, especially in cases of intracranial lesions. Intracranial lesions can be the intracranial hematomas, like the traumatic intracranial hematomas. So we have to drain the hematoma, or in cases of the brain tumors or brain abscess, we have to excise these lesions to decrease the intracranial pressure. In cases of hydrocephalus, we have to go for the CSF diversion procedures like the external ventricular drain or the VP shunt or endoscopic third ventriculostomy. So these can be the definitive management procedures for the intracranial pressure. So thank you for today.